If you have your copy of God's Word, I'd like for you to turn to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 2, be reading from this morning. Revelation chapter 2, we're going to look at verses 8 through 11. And when you get there, if you're able to stand, I'd like to ask you to stand for the reading of God's Word. Revelation chapter 2, start with verse 8. And here the Bible says, "And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, These things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. I know thy works, and tribulation, and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews, and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that you may be tried, and you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death." Heavenly Father, I come to you this morning, Lord, thanking you for the reading of your word. I ask you now, God, to anoint me for just a few minutes, Lord, to be able to expound on this text, Lord, to glorify you. God, keep me small and out of the way, and let you be seen and visible this morning, and let you be the one that's seen, God. Let people leave from this congregation today, Lord, knowing what a mighty God that we serve. These things I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. You can be seated. This letter that was written to the churches, at the beginning of the book of Revelation, you'll find the seven churches of Asia that are written to by John, as the Lord gives John the visions from the Isle of Patmos as he's cast there because he's been preaching the word of God. He's been sentenced there to bust up rocks on that Isle of Patmos. That's what they did there, the prisoners. But as he's there, the Lord Jesus comes to him. John says he was there on the Lord's day. And the Lord came to him and appeared to him, and he fell down at his feet as he was dead. And then we find that he starts giving the message to the seven churches of Asia. Now, this is not the Asia as we think of today. It's more of modern day Turkey in that area of what it is, but it's the ancient Asia as we see in the Bible. But here, this church is one of the churches that's mentioned there. That's one of the smaller of the churches. It's one of the most, you might call it one of the insignificant churches, if you want to use that term. It's not mentioned anywhere else in the Bible, except for in the book of Revelation. Here it's mentioned in Revelation, but nowhere else will you find this church mentioned. The church was most likely started by followers of Paul, as Paul was down there in Ephesus working. I believe he was there about 2 years preaching the gospel. And it's very close, about 40 miles away from Ephesus. And the city was founded itself by Alexander the Great. And so it was known for being a great seaport in there at the Aegean Sea that it was encompassed around. There was a great long seaport. You can see pictures on the internet if you pull up the map of that area, of a long port that runs up into the land there. And they would dock the ships and they would do a trade route through there. And so a lot of people passing in and out in those ancient days. Well, history tells us that the Apostle John, who was the human penman of the book of Revelation, was also a friend or a counterpart of a man named Polycarp. I don't know if you've heard of this man, but he was a great preacher of that day, a bishop. And it's believed that John appointed Polycarp as one of the bishops of this church here in Smyrna. And so Polycarp, a very interesting man, a great man of God and a great believer, and had great faith in the Lord. A faith that, as we see in Fox's Book of Martyrs, he gave his life for Christ. I want to read you the account of Polycarp. Now, Polycarp's not mentioned in our text in the Bible, but history gives us a little information about him. Fox's Book of Martyrs says this about Polycarp. It says he was the bishop of Smyrna, and hearing that persons were seeking for him, escaped, but was discovered by a child. After feasting the guards who apprehended him, he desired an hour in prayer, which being allowed, he prayed with such fervency that his guards repented that they had been instrumental in taking him. He was, however, carried before the proconsul and condemned and burnt in the marketplace. The proconsul then urged him, saying, "Swear, and I will release thee. Reproach Christ." But Polycarp answered, 80 and 6 years have I served him, and he never once wronged me. How then shall I blaspheme my king who has served me? At the stake to which he was only tied but not nailed as usual, as he assured them he would stand immovable. The flames on their kindling, the faggots encircled his body like an arch without touching him. And the executioner on seeing this was ordered to pierce him with a sword when so great a quantity of blood flowed out as extinguished the fire. But his body at the instigation of the enemies of the gospel, especially the Jews, was ordered to be consumed in the pile and the request of his friends who wished to give it a Christian burial rejected. They nevertheless collected his bones and as much of his remains as possible and caused them to be decently interred. And so this man, this bishop there of Smyrna, this great man Polycarp, he gave his life for the cause of Christ. How many today are willing to give your life for Christ? He gave his life for us. You know, he doesn't command our lives. A lot of gods today that men worship, a lot of these folks that worship these false gods, these gods command the lives of his followers. Our God does not command that we give our lives for him. He gave his life for us. And all he asks of us is to live a life for him and follow him. That's what he requires of us. Well, so Smyrna was a church that was properly grounded in the faith. They had real men of God that preached in that church. And it is only one of the two churches of the seven churches of Asia that the Lord Jesus didn't have anything bad to say about. If you recall reading through that list of those churches, he would give some of their good things, he would point out, and then he would say, "Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee." And then he would start pointing out all these things that they were doing that was wrong and how they needed to repent of those and turn from that in order to be pleasing to the Lord and for him not to destroy their churches. Well, two of the churches of that list, he did not have anything negative to say about. In fact, all he said was good things about them and mentioned how they were being persecuted against. This church and the church of Philadelphia were the only two churches that he didn't have bad things to say about. Verse 8 of our text where we opened up with, the Bible says this, and by the way, this is the Lord Jesus speaking. If you have a red letter edition Bible such as my old Schofield King James Bible, the letters are written in red to let us know that this is the words of the Lord Jesus speaking. Now, that's not necessary. You don't have to have your words written in red in your Bible. You can understand it by reading it. But it's a help for us to be able to go through and say, hey, we need to remember here. This is the words of Jesus speaking. It's not some man speaking. It's not some world's idea that's been given here. This is what God has said through Jesus Christ. And he says in verse 8, and unto the angel of the church of Smyrna. And by the way, the word angel right there is referring to their bishop or their minister, the leader of that church. And he's telling John to give this letter to this minister or this angel of the church in Smyrna. And he says, write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. The first and the last is referring to the Lord. The Lord has always been and always will be. He's always been. He's never had a beginning and he will not have an end, but he is the beginning and he is the end. So it all entails the Lord. And so he's the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. And we sung about that in the choir this morning. And my mother's song was talking about all those terms that was referring to the Lord Jesus and what we call him and all those wonderful things the Bible says about him. But this is, he says, who was once dead but now is alive. That describes the Lord Jesus Christ. He once was dead, but he arose again on the third day, just as he promised. And that, my friend, is the gospel, that the Lord Jesus came here and he gave his life for the sinner of this world. And he was buried in a borrowed tomb and he rose again on the third day. And so his birth and his death and his burial and his resurrection, those are the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so anybody that would have the authority here to write to the church and say, this is what God says, it's the Lord Jesus. He's the authority on the church because the Bible says he is the head of the church. Listen, your pastor is not the head of the church. I don't expect to be worshipped. I don't expect to be exalted. In fact, your pastor is just nothing but a meek and lowly servant for the Lord. I'm just the under shepherd. I'm just the one that says this is what God says. And so listen, I am not one to be exalted. The Lord Jesus is the one to be exalted. He's the head of this church. We make up the body.
And so we need to get that in order. We talked about this morning in Sunday school that God is a God of order. He has things in order that He expects. And the world tries to make it out of order. They disorder the things of God. But God has specific things in order. And one of those is the way the church operates and runs. And so He has the authority. The Apostle John, as I mentioned, is the human penman. He's writing these words. He's being inspired by God. Every word in your Bible is inspired by God and written down by a man's hand that's being inspired by God. There's no mistaking that it's the Lord Jesus speaking the words. And Jesus is the one also that has the authority to judge the church and judge men. God has given the Son judgment on man and on sin. The Bible says that the Lord Jesus loved the church so much that He gave Himself for the church. And so He died. The Lord Jesus died for the church. And He has the authority to judge it and to say what He expects from it. Over in John 5 and 22, the Bible says, "For the Father judgeth no man, but has committed all judgment unto the Son." And in John 5 and 27, it says, "And hath given Him authority to execute judgment also, because He is the Son of Man." That term, Son of Man, the Lord Jesus uses it more than any other term when referring to Himself. He uses that title more than all titles that you'll find of the Lord Jesus. He uses it. Why does He use it? Because He came here. Who did He come to die for? The world, us. He came to die for man. And so He is the Son of Man. And may I caution anyone who speaks negatively about the Lord's church. May I caution you today. Woe unto those that bring strife and contention and tries to do things against God's church. You're treading on dangerous ground when you start messing with the bride of Christ. And let me tell you something today. The Bible is very clear. The church is the bride of Christ. The church is God's espoused. And so He loved the church, like I said, that He gave His life for it. But I'm not talking about this building. We have a beautiful building. Everybody that comes here says, "Brother Byron, you have a beautiful church building." And thank God for that. I'm so thankful that He blessed us with this building. But if we didn't even have this building, if we were meeting down there in that little fellowship building, friends, wherever the people of God are congregated together, that is the church. If we were meeting out here in the grass, that's the church. And so when I tell you to take caution not to speak against the church, I'm talking about the people in the church. Those that have been saved by the blood of Christ and are part of the body of Christ. We are the church. You and I that are saved, we are the church. And so woe unto those that come against God's bride. Paul, he had this thought in his mind. He was writing to the Corinthians, that troubled church. And listen to what he said. 2 Corinthians 11 and 2, he said, "For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ." And so Paul's trying to drive home to that church, listen, you are being prepared for Jesus Christ. And so all these things that you once did in your former life before you were saved, those things that draw you, that sin that so easily besets you, that thing that you may think that you might want to get back into, you don't need to be into that, because you're being prepared to be connected with your groom, with Christ. You are the bride, and I'm jealous over you. And so Paul watched over that church. I mean, he was like a hawk. You know, a hawk way up there in the sky, and he can look down. He can see the tiniest thing down on the ground. A little mouse running across a field, and you'll see a hawk come down and swoop down and grab that thing. He can see it all. Paul was up there looking over the church, and he says, "Listen, I'm jealous over you because I'm trying to protect you. I'm trying to prepare you for the time when you meet Christ." And so Paul was watching over the church. And then later on in the book of Revelation, and John, the human penman, again, Revelation 21 and 9, there toward the end, he says this, he says, "And there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, Come hither, I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife." And so there's no mistake about it. We are getting prepared to be joined with the Lord Jesus. And listen, and you listen to me well. You don't want to mess around with a man's bride. You don't want to mess around with the Lord's wife, His bride, the church. And so listen, you start going against the church, you're going against the Lord. And He's protected over His church.
Verse 9 of our opening text there back in Revelation chapter 2, he said, I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Listen, one thing that we need to be aware of, which he said there in that verse, the first four words there, he said, I know thy works. And we better be sure right now, friend, God knows our works. You're not hiding anything from God. He knows those works that you did for yourself, and he knows those works that you really did for him. And he knows the works of Highland Baptist Church. He knew the works of Smyrna, and he knows the works of Highland Baptist Church. And we need to be aware of that. You can pretend to be something all day long. And listen, you may fool a lot of people. I've known a lot of men that stood up and said they were called by God to preach the gospel. And I've known a lot of men that's fallen, that wasn't truly called by God, but they'd given up, had stood up behind a pulpit in their own power, in their own flesh, and then they failed and they stumbled, and now they're no longer even in the ministry. Listen, I want you to know today that the Lord knows our works. You can fool people, you can't fool God. And those Christians today, I have to wonder about them, that say they're saved, say they trusted Jesus, but yet they live their life like the world, and then they magically pop up on a Sunday morning or Sunday night, sometimes Wednesday nights, magically come to church, but yet the rest of their life, they're living like the world. They're living just like the sin-filled world. And you couldn't tell them apart if they were put up in a lineup with the world and say, which one's the Christian? You would not be able to tell the Christian from the non-Christian. And I'm a fear today that people have gotten a misunderstanding of what God's grace means. They have perverted God's grace, thinking that they're able to do whatever they please because they're under grace. No, friends, that's not the truth. Paul said, God forbid that you do that. And so let's not forget these verses as well. Romans 12 and 1 through 2 says this. It says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which, by the way, is your reasonable service. I added in there, is your reasonable service, the Bible says. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. If you want to be in God's will, you're going to live a life pleasing to the Lord. That's what the Bible says. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. This is not Brother Byron's philosophy or doctrine or theology. It's what the Bible says. And the Bible says if you want to be in God's perfect will of God, you will perform your reasonable service. And what does he say you need to do? You need to renew your mind. You need to get your mind out of the world and get it on the Lord. That's your reasonable service. He didn't say unreasonable. He didn't say the hard thing to do. He said, listen, it's not unreasonable for me to ask this of you, to tell you this is what you're to do. It's not unreasonable. And by the way, when you were saved, you wasn't just saved to keep yourself out of hell. Do you know that? Some people think, well, the only reason we got saved was to keep us from out of hell. No, friend. No, that was a very great thing that God did for us to keep us out of hell. But there were several other things because of our salvation. But I want you to know the Bible says that we were saved unto good works. Hey, everybody wants to quote that first part there in Ephesians, you know, how we're saved by grace and, you know, not by works, lest any man should boast and all that, saved by grace through faith. But they want to fail to quote the next part and where it talks about where we are saved unto good works, Ephesians 2 and 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. So listen. He didn't just save you to save you from hell. He saved you to go to work for him, to go into good works. So you wasn't called to be a pew plopper. All right? You ever heard of that term? A pew plopper. There's a lot of pew ploppers today. There's no workers. And so we need to understand that. He saved us with a full expectation we would do good works pleasing to him and as our reasonable service because that's his will. That's the will of God. And the Lord said here to this church of Smyrna that he knows thy works. He knows your works. He knows this church works. He also says there that he knows about the tribulation. The tribulation. And we know that word tribulation, that's when somebody comes under great pressure. Great things are happening to them. They're going under trials and things. This church was under great pressure. Not only from the Romans, but from the Jews, the unbelieving Jews, that were always pressuring them and coming against them, persecuting them. Remember, they're under the rule of a Roman emperor at this time.
Now, the Romans were wicked people. The Romans were notorious for persecuting Christians. And that day that they were living in, around the time period of this, the Roman emperor's name was Domitian. And he was one of the most cruelest Roman emperors there ever was. In fact, he's the only Roman emperor that he commanded his people to call him Dominus Aedius. You know what that means? It means master and God. The Roman emperor declared that he would be called master and God. Well, he was also deadly set against Christianity. And that's why John was out there on Isle of Patmos in the first place. But this church was under that kind of rule. And so John is telling him, the Lord Jesus is telling him through John's writing here. He says, listen, I know about your tribulation. I know how they've come up on you. I know what you're going through. And this Roman emperor here, he worshiped a god, the god Jupiter. And he also worshiped Minerva, the patron goddess of wisdom. He even had a shrine for Minerva built in his bedroom. And he had coins made with her emblem on those. And Domitian was an awful man. Even his own family hated him. His wife was part of a plan that had him murdered. And so this is a bad man. But the Lord goes on to talk to this church in Smyrna. He says, he mentioned their poverty. Now, for some reason unknown to us, this church is particularly poor. Whether it was because they've been ransacked, because they've been persecuted, somebody had taken everything from them. It wasn't spiritual poverty, as some people may teach right here. It wasn't a spiritual poverty. They had spiritual about them. It was enough so that the Lord mentioned their poverty. And it could be because of this tribulation, the persecution and suffering, they've been made this way. Well, because he goes on to say this, but thou art rich. Listen, I know about your poverty, but listen, you're rich. You're rich. When I grew up, we didn't have a lot. We didn't have a lot of money. I didn't get to go out like my children get to go out today and get things. And we didn't go to restaurants. We went like once a month. We could go to McDonald's when my dad got paid. And we got on the 25th, and we stood on the couch at the window waiting for the mailman to come and put his check in the mailbox so we could go out. It's one time a month. And so we didn't have money all the time. We didn't go up to my parents and say, can you give me 20 bucks? You know, I want to do this. That was unheard of. But I want you to know what we did have. We had great riches. It may not have been in money, but it was in love. It was in spirit. It was in the things of the Lord. Hey, listen, I know some people didn't grow up like I did. I was so blessed. I don't know what it's like to live in a home where my parents hit each other or cussed each other. I never, ever heard any of that. Never saw any of that. That never happened in my home. I was a blessed boy, and I'm thankful for that. But I know some people didn't get to experience that, and I hate that for them. But I want you to know we were rich, not in money, but in blessings. And this church right here, they may not have had a lot. They may not have had a fine building like we have today. And we know they didn't worship in these types of buildings. But beside the point, they didn't have a lot. But they had richness. They had the things of the Lord. And listen, don't ever try to compare the things of God to riches. That's contrary to the teaching of the Bible. God doesn't say, believe on me and have all your heart's desire and riches and homes and cars and planes and vacations and all this stuff. Now, these hucksters on TV today, you can listen to one of these guys. They'll get up there and they'll stand with their million-dollar smile and fancy suit and everything and stand there and tell you, you know, oh, God just wants to give you everything of your heart's desire. That's what they'll say today. They'll stand up there and they'll smile and they'll tell you all this stuff. I fly in a jet airplane because God has blessed me with great riches. Oh, listen, friends. Listen, don't ever compare God's blessings with riches. We know that there was, it teaches us there in the book of Luke where we have the rich man and the poor man, and which one was in hell? It was the rich man. And riches didn't send him there. It was his unbelief in Christ that sent him there. That's where every rich man will go if he doesn't believe in Christ. So riches and poorness has nothing to do with it in money sense. It's all spiritual sense. He said, I know thy blasphemy. And he isn't talking about blaspheme against God. He's talking about this church has been blasphemed against by these outsiders here. This synagogue of Satan, of these Jews that's over here. And it's because of their religion, because of their belief in Christ. They're in the way. They're in the truth. He says, of them which say they are Jews and are not,
but are the synagogue of Satan. The synagogue of Satan. Underline that in your Bible. There were only two churches, like I mentioned, in these seven churches that Jesus didn't have anything to say about. And both of these churches, Jesus specifically mentions, they were being persecuted by the synagogue of Satan. The synagogue of Satan. And you say, well, what's that mean, preacher? Well, I'm glad you ask. In the days of the Jews, of course, we know that the Jews met in these synagogues. Everywhere there was a certain amount of people, they would set a synagogue up, and that's where they would gather together to do their worship in. And we know that. That's a synagogue. It's an assembly of a place where they would assemble together. And in the days of the Jews, in John, the day John was living in, it was unbelieving Jews that were residing in these synagogues. They didn't believe in Jesus Christ. They rejected Christ. He came into his own received him not. So they rejected him. And so when they would come together, assemble together under their pretense of worship, they say they're worshiping God, but really they were worshiping religion, just like the Pharisees. And Jesus come to them, and they were coming against him. And what did Jesus say? You're of your father, the devil. Yeah, that's what he called him. He said their father was the devil, the father of all lies. And so these people, they may have been religious in pretense and practice. They went through all the routines. They kept the laws and did all these man-made laws that they refrained from. And they were assembling together as a religious a meeting. But yet they were really the synagogue of Satan. Anything that opposes Jesus Christ, you can attribute to Satan. Hey, you've heard of Antichrist? That's something that's against God. It's complete opposite of Christ. That's why in the end of times, you'll find the Antichrist, the man, the son of perdition, will come up and he will resemble the things of Christ. He will try to do the things of Christ, but it'll be the opposite. And so that is Antichrist. Anything that comes against Jesus Christ, against his church, against what Jesus teaches and preaches is Antichrist. And so if you're against Jesus, you're against his church, you're against Christianity, then you are of the synagogue of Satan. You're of the synagogue of Satan. Some people try to take this out of context and say, no, it's specifically talking about the Jews and it's replacement theology and all this. I'm not going to talk about that today. But listen, they're misconstrued on this. He's simply talking about these people that have came against them. They're persecuting them. They're blaspheming the church, which is the things of Jesus. And so, therefore, they are the synagogue of Satan. I believe in these last days we're living in, this world is filled full of synagogues of Satan. And we don't call these buildings today synagogues, do we? No, we call these New Testament churches and Baptist churches. If you're of the Baptist faith, it's a Baptist church. All right? And certainly, a lot of the churches that are in existence today are not churches of Jesus Christ. They're not New Testament-based churches. These churches are made up of people that go through a religious routine. They go through some kind of pretense of worship. And they go through all the things and do all the things, and they look good from the surface. But in their hearts, friends, they are not the synagogue of the Jew or the synagogue of Christ. They're the synagogue of Satan. They're teaching things behind the pulpit today that has nothing to do with the Lord Jesus Christ or salvation or faith in God. Hey, we've got limp-wristed, penny-wasted preachers standing behind pulpits today preaching the world's theology and the world's means and the world's ideas that has nothing to do with God. I mentioned those preachers that stand up and talk about riches and how God's going to bless you with money and homes and all these things like that. Friends, that's not the preaching of Jesus Christ. The Bible says he didn't even have a place to lay his head. And so don't you come to me and tell me, no, Jesus wants me to have money. It's not what my Bible says. You know what Jesus wants you to have? Faith. He wants you to have faith and obedience. That's what he's interested in above all of the things. Hey, so if you've been blessed with riches in this earth, I'm glad for you, okay? I don't know what that's like. Don't care. I don't care. But we've got these people today that'll stand up, and they're even today in Baptist churches that are allowing sodomites to get up and claim to be men of God. That's going on right. You know, behind pulpits of churches today, they're allowing men that claim that they are lovers of other men to stand behind a pulpit and preach. And they have a congregation. You want to tell me that's the church of Jesus? It's certainly not. You cannot be a man of God and a sodomite in the same time, okay? It's not possible. The darkness and light doesn't mix. And so we've got these today that they're standing up and declaring they're men of God, but they're preaching the world's things and they're not men of God. Listen, you can put lipstick on a pig all day long and put a dress on it and call it a beauty queen. It ain't nothing but a pig. Nothing but a pig. We raise pigs. I know what I'm talking about.
I could go up there on the hill behind the pig pen where we used to go and dump the slop. Hey, I could put some lipstick on that pig and say, boy, look at that beauty queen. You know what that pig's going to do? He's going to get down in that slop, and he's going to wallow around in that mud, and he'll come out just covered in that stuff. That's what he does. That's because he's a pig. So these men that stand up and say, I'm a man of God, and it's okay to be a sodomite and preach. No, friends. No, it doesn't work that way. Still a pig. That's why Jesus, he's talking to these other churches. He says, I have somewhat against thee. There's a reason. Because they were doing the things that opposed Christ. Well, because this church of Smyrna was doing all the right things, everybody knew it. They were known. The world knew that. The Jews knew it. The Romans knew it. Everybody knew it. That's why they're being persecuted against. As I said in my Sunday school class today, if you don't want to be tried for your faith, if you don't want to go through problems in this life, don't live for Christ. The world wouldn't have a thing to do with you. They don't care. You just be like part of them. Hey, but you want to live a life that is pleasing to God, living God's will, you'll live a life pleasing to Him. I want you to know that today. And you will not live like the world would live. And listen, you'll live for Christ. We're going to answer to God one day. We will stand before the Lord Jesus. He's going to be our judge. Even if you're saved, you will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Don't think that you're immune from that. Not judge for your sins, but judge for your works, the things that you've done. The Bible tells us very plain. What are we going to say when the Lord Jesus stands there? If you've been saved and you say you're a called preacher and you stand up and you never preach the Word of God and you preach man's theology, what will you say when the Lord says, why didn't you preach about Jesus? Why were you preaching these other things? What are we going to say? Well, I didn't want to upset anybody. I just want to get along with everybody. I want everybody to love us. You know, I love them too much to tell them all that stuff. Is that what we're going to say? You're not going to say that in front of the Lord. Friends, I want you to know when you get in front of the Lord, you're going to fall on your face. You're going to bow to your knees in front of His holiness and righteousness. And there's not going to be a word come out of your mouth. Not a word. Well, we didn't want to single anybody out. You know, we didn't want to be known as that church that talked about sinners and everything. We didn't want to point out sin. It's okay if you just cover it, you know, lightly and say, don't sin. Everybody's okay with that, aren't they? Hey, you start categorizing it. You start pointing it out. You start making it specific. And you know what? All of a sudden, you're stomping toes. You're punching people. And you say, Brother Byron, you ought to have more loving spirit about you when you preach. Listen, I love people enough to keep them out of hell. I love you so much, I want to tell you what Jesus says. And He says to repent of these sins. Believe it or not, Paul was facing some of the same problem as we're facing today with these nobody with a backbone standing up. They'd already went back to the way they were. Listen to what he said to the church in Galatia. And boy, he let them have it. Galatians 1 and 6, he said this. He said, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you unto the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. But there be some that trouble you and will pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that you have received, let him be accursed. And listen to what he said. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. Listen, these people are getting up to please men, to tickle ears, to be loved by everybody. Listen, I love you. I love you in Christ. But I'd rather tell you what Jesus says than to make you think that you're all lovey-dovey and good. There is none good, the Bible says. There's none righteous. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we must know that today. Anytime you teach or preach the truth, you will be opposed. The synagogue of Satan will stand up and oppose you. You better believe it. And so we will continue to stand. We'll continue to preach against sin. We'll preach hard against sin, by the way. Hard against it. But like Paul said, do I now persuade men or am I going to preach for Christ? Because if I'm trying to persuade men, if I'm trying to please men, I am not a minister of Christ. I'm not a preacher of Christ. He said, I should not be the servant of Christ. Verse 10, and we're finished. Fear none of them. None of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that you may be tried.
And you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. You know, when you stand up and say what's right and you preach what's right, you stand for the truth, you walk in your school, kids, when you go to school and you stand up for the Lord and you walk in faith, they will laugh at you. They'll make fun of you. They'll act like you're some kind of weirdo. But I want you to know you'll be pleasing to God, and it doesn't matter. When you stand before Christ, He's not going to look and say, I'm sorry they made fun of you. He's going to say, you should have expected that because you walked for me. The Bible says it's very plain there that we will be suffering things because of our faith. And when you stand up, there'll be some consequences. But that's when we got to stand up, we got to get a backbone about us, and we got to say, this is right, that is wrong, and this is what the Bible says, and let the Lord deal with it. Hey, this church at Smyrna has suffered persecution, some even unto death, even like their own Polycarp, as we read in history. He suffered unto death for his faith. So we are to do the right thing, live for the Lord. And what did he say there? He said, I'll give thee a crown of life. I'll choose a crown of life over all the riches of the world. I'll choose to be pleasing to God than pleasing to all the men of the world. If every man on this earth hates me for what I preach, I'm glad for it, as long as I'm pleasing to the Lord. What about you today? Is your life pleasing to the Lord? When you stand before Him, what will your excuse be? Will you stand there before Him guilty? Lord, yes, I didn't live a life for you. I know Brother Byron got up and he said that we were to live a life that was pleasing to you. We were to do good works that you expected that of us. But God, I wasn't cut out for it. You don't want to stand before the Lord like that. I want to stand before the Lord and be able to stand there and listen to what He says. And listen, probably half of everything I've ever done is going to get burned up like wood, hay, and stubble. I'll just be honest with you today. If you'll be honest with yourself, you're the same way. There are going to be some of these people that will stand before the Lord that you've never heard their names. You don't know a thing about them, but they have lived a life under the Lord that is so pleasing, and they have done so much for Him and not for themselves, and they're going to be walking out of there with so many crowns they can't carry them. I'm going to be one of them standing there just thankful I fave and get one old rusty one, you know. Hey, be pleasing to God. I'm going to ask them to come and get the invitation song this morning. And I don't know everybody's heart in this building today. There may be one here that's lost. Maybe one here that's never trusted the Lord Jesus as their Savior. Unless you may say, well, why would I want to do that if I'm going to suffer persecution? You know what the alternative is? To die and go to a devil's hell where you will burn for eternity in a lake of fire. That's the alternative. To live a life pleasing to God, it's not an easy life. I'm not going to stand here and tell you if you just trust Jesus, your life will be a bed of roses. No, but I want you to know your life will be eternal. Your life will be forever. And the Lord will bless you. He loves His people. He watches over them. Just like Paul said, with a godly jealousy. I want to ask you to stand this morning. If you need help, whether it be for salvation, a backslidden condition, if you just need prayer, you come down this altar. The altars are open. You come down and we'll pray. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for the message. Lord, I pray that it's been pleasing to you. God, I'm thankful, Lord, that you don't hold anything back from your word. God, you've let us have it with both barrels. And God, we know the truth. The truth has been spoken from your word, not from my words, not from my heart, God, from your heart. And God, we trust in that today. Lord, we know you're the Savior of men. God, if there's one here today that is lost, has never trusted the Lord Jesus, God, if you would convict that heart through the Holy Spirit, God, show them the need to be saved before it's too late. And bring them to this altar, God, so that we can pray with them. Lord, if there's one here today, would you lead them to this altar? Help us, Father. Help us, Father. Everybody keep praying.